Look at all the people here tonight.
Fightin' and trouble are my middle name. I was raised in the canebrake by an old mama lion. Can't know a high-toned woman make me walk the line. You load 16 tons.
It's a love that I found ever since you've been around. Your love put me on the top of the world. Top of the world.
Permit me here and now to promise, as a good comrade and a fellow artist, that I will not report any of this, whatever it is, to the police.
Welcome to Abandoned Albums, the documentary podcast. Each week, our intrepid group of researchers and music archivists dig through the record crates of the world, finding those albums that may have been lost over time. If a new artist is discovered along the way, well, that's all the better. Using a patent-pending algorithm and spirited debate, we pick one album as an inroad to discuss. Once that is settled, we reach out to the artists and invite them into Thunderlove Studio to chat with your hosts, Keith R. Higgins and Jeff Calhoun. When we're lucky, they say yes. Our mission with Abandoned Albums is simple: to make sure artists' recorded work remains, or in some cases, lands on, the cultural radar. We invite you to sit back and relax. Thank you for joining us.
And now, a word from our sponsor.
There is no denying that David Lee Roth is one of the greatest frontmen to front a rock and roll band. And when he left, got fired, got kicked out, whatever, of Van Halen, he naturally began a solo career. Initially met with success, his commercial viability began to wane over the years. And that, my friends, is when it gets interesting. His creative sojourn has included an author, DJ, filmmaker, entrepreneur, digital trailblazer, becoming an EMT, and all points in between. Suffice it to say, if David Lee Roth had an itch, creative or otherwise, he scratched it. This week's guest, Darren Paltrowitz, has led a pretty interesting life himself. In addition to being a writer, he is a music business veteran who has worked with artists like OK Go, They Might Be Giants, and Tracy Bonham. He's also the host of Paltrowcast with Darren Paltrowitz, and the top-rated podcast for David Lee Roth fans, the DLR Cast. Oh yeah, he's also a private investigator. Darren stopped by Thunderlove Studio to talk about his new book, DLR Book, How David Lee Roth Changed the World. Here's my conversation with Darren.
It's just the normal noises in here.
Darren, thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Keith.
Dave's been in the news past couple of days.
Dave has been in the news for sure. Like three times he's hit national headlines in the last 7 days.
So this is my question to you, Darren. Sure. How much do you think media plays a role in slagging David Lee Roth? Now, here's why I'm asking that question. This beef with Wolfie, with Wolfgang Van Halen.
Sure.
This fucking kid, I'm giving him the best. Everything I've got in front of 20, 30,000 people at a clip. And he's complaining to everybody around me. Cut to New York City, and we're at Jones Beach with 20,000 of my closest friends. And what I don't know is this kid, this Schlemiel kid, has commandeered a couple of monkeys to go in back behind my back over to the side of the stage and throw out these two great dames that I invited to be my guests to the show. And these dames are in their 40s, okay? Businesswomen. In fact, you aren't gonna believe this shit. This fucking kid, what he doesn't know is that these two dames work for the accounting firm that represent him, not me. But as usual, he, just like his uncle and his uncle's brother, stiffed them for tickets. I know they're gonna do that, so I got ahead of things and I give them tickets. And he throws them out of the building. He's teaching me a lesson. What this fucking kid doesn't know, they're carrying the paychecks for all 82 people on the road crew. Cut to Hollywood. We're playing the Hollywood Bowl. The brothers are playing. I walk out on stage at the Hollywood Bowl. This is the very last show that we're playing. I'm about to launch into Ice Cream Man. And this fucking kid, he commandeers two muscle monkeys, locates the one dame that is my guest. She's off in the wings of the Hollywood Bowl. They find her and throw her out of the building. Wolfie Van Halen's gonna teach me a lesson by throwing out what he thinks is my girlfriend. But guess what? Not only is this an accountant again, and not only is she carrying the paychecks for 82 of us on the road crew, but she's carrying cash bonuses for everybody there. You may wanna pull over on this next one, you're gonna pee your pants. Remember New York City? It's the same fucking lady. This fucking kid. This fucking kid!
To me, if you read the article outside of the headline, there's really not much of a beef there. I mean, outside looking in, for those listening, Wolfie apparently was cranky because Dave didn't pay enough attention to him on stage. But then if you think about it.
I have such an issue. I don't know if you want to do an 8-hour podcast, but no. I have an issue with Dave's facts. But keep going.
Okay, fair. But Dave didn't interact that much with Michael Anthony.
Correct.
So it's like, okay, you're a bass player just because you're the guitarist's son. Anyway, well, we can talk about Dave's factual bending.
Well, with Wolfie's thing, I have a couple of issues with it from Dave's end.
Okay.
And for the initial thing that you mentioned about the media's role in the whole thing, you know, in doing a lot of press on this book, there's one radio show that's had me on 6 times in the last, you know, month or so, this great Connecticut morning radio show. And the last time I was on, which was on Monday, they basically said, so what do you think about what Dave put out? And what I'm getting at is they only listened to the first 2 or 3 minutes about the slagging Sammy in the first one. They didn't keep listening so that they didn't know about the Eddie parts, meaning a lot of people just went, oh, okay, well, it's going to be 25 minutes of him slagging Sammy. I think that the media isn't necessarily reporting fairly or fully on the whole situation. They're not researching some of the things that Dave says. So when I say that I have issues with Dave's facts here, this latest one about Wolfie, he's like, we're playing in New York City. We're playing at Jones Beach. Mm-hmm. Okay. Jones Beach is on Long Island. Correct. I live on Long Island. Jones Beach is within 5 miles of here.
Okay.
I do not live in New York City. Jones Beach is not in New York City. Jones Beach does not have a hotel within a mile of it. It is a remote place in the middle of a parkway.
Yes.
It is not New York City. And as a licensed private investigator, I've kind of been trained that when one or two facts are wrong, you go to the judge or the attorney or whatever, and you go, this is wrong. What else is wrong here? So there's so many holes in the arguments of what Dave's saying, aside from the Sammy being probed by aliens, that you just have to go, okay, I'm going to dig into this. And what else is Dave half-truthing or wronging about? And there's so much.
Yeah. Let's talk about the probing. I didn't go deep in that. I'm like, I don't have time for Dave on this one. This just seems like gibberish.
Sammy did say it in an interview. He did say that, but he didn't. I don't think he went into depth so much about what happened during the probing, during the alien abduction. I think Dave filled in a few details.
We interrupt our program to bring you this important message.
Tonight, the ballad of Popsicle Sam and Sketchy Joe.
I've read on the internet specifically here. I would never dare impugn or infer or even imagine this out loud. But according to Sam, he was abducted by aliens.
4 o'clock in the morning, pitch black, dead sleep. I felt like I was being programmed. Like someone was tapping into me, like it was a string from my head to 13 miles up on a mountain, a place called Lyle Creek. And I know right where it was, this little foothills, at the foothills, there was an object there. There was two people in it, two creatures in it. And I sensed they were tapping into me somehow. And they went, oh, he's waking up. All mental telepathy, you know, the communication went in my head. He's waking up. They yelled out a numerical code, not of our numerical system. It was like, and it went. And I could almost feel the plug, like an electrical charge, leaving, zapped into their ship, put a light on in the ship where I see shadows of these creatures. And I woke up in my house and my bed. My room was infinity white. I couldn't move. I was completely paralyzed. My eyes were open. And all of a sudden, bam, it just went black, and it was the time it was, and I broke sweat, and I was shaken, and I felt like my body was so drained, and from that moment on, I believed in UFOs.
I am compelled to solicit this sordid subject in an effort to explain Sam Hagar's conduct. For the last 10 summers, I haven't said a single syllable about him, and I think we've arrived at both the technical and the medical answer that may explain some of Sammy Hagar's conduct and his constant spew of diarrhea vitriol in our direction. Sammy Hagar was abducted by aliens, and he was sex probed, Tom. Sex probed.
We return you now to your regularly scheduled program.
A licensed private investigator, how do you go from writing to being a private investigator?
It was really a growth of me being a writer, researcher, a person who has a master's in library and information sciences, and going, hey, the music industry is getting smaller and smaller and smaller, and there's fewer jobs for people who know stuff. And it's more about what boxes do you check? And I figured, okay, I better start looking. And a neighbor saw my skill set and went, you should work here. And that was some years ago. And here I am as a PI who has a book and a podcast and a TV show and too many job titles.
Let's talk about our introduction, each of our introductions into Van Halen. I don't know. I'm presuming we're in the same ballpark of age. Probably you're a Gen Xer, I assume.
I was born in 82. I don't know what that is.
That is actually right at the tail end. That is the last year of Gen X.
Sometimes I'm told I'm a millennial, and I go, I'm not a millennial. Don't do that.
No. Van Halen was my coming of age, and I was there for all the hoopla when Sammy came on, and I'm one of those rare people. I don't hate the Sammy Hagar era.
No.
It's not my favorite. It's not what I go to listen to ever, but there's some good stuff there. Mine was always Dave. And to me, David Lee Roth is one of the greatest frontmen in rock and roll, full stop.
No question.
Yeah. How did you get introduced?
Due to my age, it was MTV and VH1, the hits. And then over time, you kind of connect the personality behind the hits. And the book, Crazy from the Heat, was where I really, really became a diehard fan, not just a person who liked the hits.
Okay.
And from there, you know, you go back and you watch every interview you can, and you get every juicy tidbit you can, and you just wait for Dave to emerge. And then the internet happens and YouTube happens, and then you can go even further back. You didn't have to be born at a certain time to have seen it. So the obsession has been gradual and evolving and deeper and deeper. And today I found like another 1991 concert that was just posted of Dave's. So,
oh, really? Okay.
Yeah. You never know when you're going to find new stuff. It could be every day. It could be every couple of weeks.
He is an interesting, interesting individual. And I had no idea until I read your book that Michael McDonald was a co-writer on All Wait all these years. Never had an idea. Never knew that.
Again, thank you for getting the book. And that dispels another thing that Dave says in his podcasts of absolutes. And he goes, me and Eddie wrote all the music in Van Halen. Well, no, All Wait was written with Michael McDonald. And I'm pretty sure you didn't write the drum part of Hot for Teacher. Pretty sure that was written by a drummer. And yeah. Yes, Eddie was a competent drummer. And pretty yeah. sure that bass solo from Michael Anthony in the early 80s became the 1984 intro, or at least inspired it. Pretty sure you didn't write all the music, Dave.
Where do you land on the rumor that Michael Anthony did not play bass on some of those records once Eddie built his studio, which I mm-hmm. think was right around Fair Warning? Where do you land on that?
Oh, I think we got a pretty definitive answer on this. It only took 40 something years, but we got it within the last week or so with Greg Renoff's interview with Don Landy. And Don Landy goes, I can't think of one song where Michael Anthony didn't play bass and Eddie did. So Don Landy has a good memory.
Yeah.
Sorry, Don Landy, as far as we know, was a sober, focused, there for business kind of guy. He wasn't ever the social darling that was photographed to red carpets. Don Landy had a job to do, and that was to record, engineer, mix.
Yeah.
Sometimes under the helm of Ted Templeman, sometimes other people. And I'm going to take Don Landy's word personally.
Yeah, for sure. He would know more than anybody.
Now, let me backtrack. We did see and hear at the beginning of the pandemic, or close to the beginning, around the time of Eddie's passing, and there were so many tributes, there was this Sunset Sound YouTube-based podcast, and they were listening to some of the unreleased 2004 box set. And they played an outtake of Hot for Teacher, or discussed it, where it was the bass part duplicating the guitar line of Eddie. And I guess they feel that Michael Anthony couldn't play that, or maybe he wasn't up to playing that. And then if you notice, that's not on the album. So why would Eddie have played a more simple part if he could have played the original right. demo part?
Girls, I really did.
called out Eddie Van Halen for his extracurricular activities.
Musically speaking, correct?
Musically speaking, yeah, musically speaking. You know, the stuff that he did. And then because Eddie said at the time Dave left, he's like, oh, he wants to be a movie star. And what I took from your perspective was, well, Eddie was doing extracurricular stuff too. But my argument would be he stayed in his lane. He just stuck to music. To my knowledge, I don't think it impacted Van Halen. It didn't hinder them from doing anything.
I disagree about musically staying in his lane because there was film projects.
Yeah, but they were music related. There were soundtracks.
Good points. Supposedly, the Crazy from the Heat movie was supposed to be more of a musical venture. That this wasn't Dave going like, I'm the next coming of comedy. It was going to be a movie that had a real soundtrack. And that soundtrack was going to be what became Crazy from the Heat.
Okay. And is it safe to say that Crazy from the Heat became that, what was it, No Holds Barbecue?
I think it would have been better than No Holds Barbecue because Jerry Prezigian was co-writing a script. So you had a real writer. And then you would have had studio people to give notes and go, listen, Dave, we know you're great. We know you're great. But in other words, there would have been people around who could manage and distract the movie star with stuff. You know, hey, here's the company card. Why don't you go shopping? And yeah. Then while he's shopping, they, oh, we don't know where that footage went. Oh, boy. You know, that kind of stuff.
I had watched some of it like years ago when I was working. Someone's like, yeah, this David Lee Roth thing is bananas. And I watched it again this afternoon. And I'm like, no, it's bananas. It's
unwatchable. The music is great.
Yeah.
But it's unwatchable, most of it. I mean, the Mean Street cover, aside from the new lyrics he comes up with, some of it is cringe, but the music performances are generally good and the songs are good. It's just to get to that, you have to watch him go like, hey, this is Tom and David, you're at the Mojo Dojo. And then the big, like fake smile thing. And then him being chased by the Dom triplets and security guards in costume and the little person exploitation slows hour yelling at them. And it's too much.
It is way too much. And I had no idea this existed. The Roth Project.
Yeah. Kind of got buried.
Yeah. And I only found it like 2 hours ago. And it's not my cup of tea. But I was like, this is actually pretty impressive.
When you go through the Dave discography or a Wikipedia kind of thing, you're trained to think like, okay, 91 was A Little Ain't Enough, and 94 is Your Filthy Little Mouth, and 98 was DLR Band, and 2003, I think, was Diamond Dave. And you're like, well, yes, but 95 was Vegas, and 96 was the Van Halen reunion, and 97 was the autobiography, and No Holds Barbecue, and he's always created stuff. It's just, it's not in a linear, easy to digest, easy to track kind of fashion.
No, it's definitely not linear. Now the book is titled, DLR book, How David Lee Roth Changed the World. Help us understand how he changed the world.
There's a lot of easy ways you could point that out. You know, putting you on the spot here, Keith, did early MTV change the world?
Absolutely.
Yeah, changed how people dressed, their consumer habits, etc. And few bands were more prominent in early MTV than David Lee Roth and Van Halen. You know, Jump and Panama and Hot for Teacher were staples that still every time there was a, you know, top 50 videos of all time when MTV does its holiday countdown so everyone can take a vacation, they would have Van Halen in there. So just from that alone. Then there's so many things where he was the first or one of the first people to do it. He put out a website exclusive single in 97. I mean, that's before Public Enemy. That's before Bowie. There's a lot of things he was the first person to do. Making your whole rock album in Spanish. Yes, Christina Aguilera 15 years later would be doing that. But whether or not you recognize it, the first, one of the first to do a lot of things and doing it that way for decades. So I feel like he changed the world indirectly and directly both.
I think it's, he had a tremendous impact. And I was saying this to a friend of mine just a couple weekends ago. I think I had this discussion with her before the Sammy Hagar stuff and before the Wolfie stuff.
Before the probing, yeah.
Yes. And I'm like, it's time to reevaluate David Lee Roth and his contributions to pop culture. You know, he's not as flaky as he comes across.
0% flaky. 0%.
And the one thing, gosh, I can't remember the name of the book right now. It's not Noel's book. It's the one that came out last year.
There's the Michael Christopher one. There's the Eruption one. There's the Steve Rosen one, Tone Chaser. Greg Renoff's book, The Backyard Band one. Okay.
That's it. I came away from that book with such a better understanding of what David Lee Roth contributed to that band. You know, he, for all intents and purposes, as I read it, was kind of the mastermind. He knew what he had, and they turned him away, what, three times?
Yeah.
You know, and he got better and got better because he knew. He knew. And it was, you know, I don't know. I don't think he gets the credit he deserves.
120%. And the more you think about Van Halen, it's the ultimate synergy. Sum of all parts is greater than any individual one. Because if it's just Dave, that's too much skibbity bop, like neon and like tight fitting clothes and bad choices and too many jokes. And if it's too much Eddie, it's too prog. It's not going to be focused. It doesn't have the commercial appeal. So when they're at their best, it's when the two of them both have a voice and are conflicting with one another, and you get a sum of the two. I say the same thing with Dave's solo career. When he has a Steve Vai, it's the right amount of prog technical stuff and zibbity bop.
Yeah.
Otherwise, you get a little ain't enough, which I think is too much Dave. And it's the beginning of the too much Dave. Ooh, ah, ooh, ah. He needs that co-pilot in management. He needs that co-pilot in the studio creative process. And you could argue that Ted Templeman was as important to Van Halen as Dave or Eddie, that he was the third part of it. According to Dave, oh, I wrote everything. And according to Ted Templeman, it's like, I was sitting next to him when he wrote the lyrics to Jump.
Yeah.
So there's so many, like, he said, and then the most sober person in the room, what they said.
He's like the master of disinformation.
Yes.
I shudder to think he ends up as a Fox correspondent.
I've found some of the Fox correspondents are our people. Forgive me for this, Keith. I consider you one of my people, our people. Mm-hmm. You clearly listen to the same records. You look for the same things. You care about who played on, wrote, produced, etc. And that's not everybody. That's 5 to 10%. But if Greg Gutfeld were in this conversation, he would be that way too. If Tyrus were in this conversation, secretly he's that way too. I'm not saying all the Fox News people. Geraldo would not be that way.
No.
There might be a photo or two with me and Geraldo, and that's a funny story. But Jerry Rivers, as we call him here on Long Island. But I think you learn with Fox, however, they're responsible for the best Dave update we'd gotten in a long time about a year or two ago. They're who basically broke the Cabo gig story, the private gig that Dave did 2 years ago, because a paparazzi person caught him at LAX.
I don't know anything about that. Share with us.
So it's talked about a little bit in my book that after Dave had retired, quote unquote, for the umpteenth time, and he didn't do Vegas, I think it was something like May 2021, paparazzi guy caught him at LAX, and it turns out, I believe it was a Fox News person, and Dave was super trying to brush off the person, like, hey, friend, like that kind of a thing. And the like a good pop, do you say pap or pop for paparazzi?
I would say pap, but...
Okay, like a good pap, you just keep throwing questions. So he threw probably four more questions at Dave than he wanted to answer. And you could see like the fake smile, like turning away a little bit, but he got that. And so people go, wait, why was Dave at LAX? And then around that same time, I was interviewing the bad boy of poker, Phil Hellmuth. And he'd been talking about what a great life and what a cool life he lives. And he's like, and I was just in Cabo the other day, and it was my friend's 50th birthday, and Coolio played there, and Cardi B played there. And I went, okay. And then I thought, okay, they saw Dave at LAX. Then some people I know related to Dave had posted Cabo vacation pictures a couple of days before then. I went, wait.
How are you, sir?
I'm doing great. We were just down in Cabo San Lucas.
Doing?
I did a birthday party.
Oh, you did?
Yeah.
For you sang?
Somebody who grew up, who was 13 years old when California Girls happened.
No kidding.
That's a big important time to a person.
Of course. Are you kidding? I'm 47, so believe me, I know more than anybody.
Oh, so I had a hand in your upbringing.
You did have a hand in my upbringing, yes.
Dave flying into LAX. LAX is a Cabo airport. Mm-hmm. And I asked Phil Hellmuth, and he got super flustered. And then later I figured out he signed an NDA, like everybody, to go to that 50th birthday party from a PayPal co-founder.
Oh, okay.
Total accident. I was just interviewing Phil because he's promoting an energy drink. And some of my interviews are the person shilling a product. And then in the last three questions, I'll throw in a Van Halen question. And then I'll see if Van Halen News Desk wants to cover that.
Yeah, I saw that in some of the people that are quoted in here. I was shocked to see the Tragically Hip in there. One of my favorite bands.
Oh, really? How Canadian are you?
I'm not that Canadian. But I just, a friend of mine who is Canadian, very Canadian, turned me on to them. And I'm like, they're one of the most incredible rock bands that just never broke here in the States.
Yeah, maybe a top 10 most famous band of all time in Canada. Mm-hmm. And then here, they're at best a one-hit wonder who was on SNL once in like 95, who played Irving Plaza.
I saw them. Yeah. There couldn't have been more than 100 people in the audience. Now, have you met David Lee Roth?
Only the 2003 intro interview that's towards the beginning of the book. That's my only direct interaction. I tried numerous times to get him involved. He basically has one manager you can go to for everything. And if you don't hear back, that means no. And I've asked this around to different people. You don't know when you're going to hear from them. It's usually Dave feels like doing it right now, and you hear from them. And then you don't hear from them for months, and then right now he wants it. So it's one of those kinds of things, meaning you don't just text Dave. You don't just email Dave. He's has people around him, and you kind of have to reach out to them or reach out to the manager to reach out to them to reach out to him.
You talk about the editor of The Barbecue.
Oh, Mark Elmer. Great guy. I consider him a friend.
Who wanted to get a picture, but felt he couldn't. And he realized by the end, it for whatever reason, the vibe he got was, as I read it, the vibe he got was like, nah, Dave doesn't want any of this. But by the end, he's like, he wouldn't have cared.
I'm trying to think of who it was before that was telling me a story about how they got a particular job because they never asked for the job after knowing that the person was high powered for 5 or 6 years. The person goes, hey, you never asked me for anything. Here it is. And there's a big difference between that and asking the person for help.
Yeah.
You never know. I don't think that you can follow any rule or line of logic and predict Dave's next thing. And that might be where the genius comes from. It also might border on insanity or illness. So you just don't know. You know, sometimes you hear the greatest stories ever that they just run into him in a bar and they go like, are you David Lee Roth? Like, yeah, hey, do you want a photo? And then there's other times where you hear or see that he's just flanked by security and you see the scowl and you don't go near him. So it's a little unpredictable. And you could say the same thing about Eddie Van Halen. You hear amazing stories all the time of, oh, I was just at Ralph's and there he was. And I talked to him and he talked to me for 20 minutes. And then you hear, oh, he was in a bad way. I guess it's just normal with creatives that how are they feeling? And that's going to guide whether or not you can get a photo.
It's funny you mentioned that. Ronnie Barnett, who's been on the show a couple of times, the bass player for the Muffs.
Oh, yeah. Oh, who's in the book. Yeah.
Yes. He's a huge David Lee Roth.
Oh, man. Yeah. He was the original Instagram account holder of @DavidLeeRoth, and it was bought from him.
Are you a David Lee Roth fan, or is that just pure snark?
Yeah, no, I am a fan. My Instagram name, like for 7 years, was, you know how you got to pick a nickname, Fuzzy Balls, and then it has your name. So my name was David Lee Roth, one word. One day I got an email to the band account from the lawyers of the, and I'll now quote, the famous singer, songwriter, author, and actor, David Lee Roth, and basically, what do you want for the name?
Yeah.
Okay, I'll give my idol his name, but you know, we have a meeting, we sign the paperwork together, we take a photo, we start our new Instagrams. But the next day, the lawyers came back and they were such pricks that I got a lawyer friend involved. I don't have a real contract, but there's the agreement signed by me, and I signed it all normal, and he signed it like David Lee fucking Roth.
It was an autograph.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
I had to actually give him my account. Like I had to clear the photos. I had to delete one by one 1,500 photos. I had to give him the password, which was Panama.
He had a great interaction with Dave at the record store he was working at. You know, yeah. He didn't recognize Dave. It was just he looked at the credit card and went, what? Well, hey.
Yeah.
And then Dave wanted to make sure that he got a good selfie.
I thought that was really sweet.
My theory, and this is only a theory, is that if you're on his payroll, he owns you, and he can ask as much as he wants of you, and it's just not going to be easy. If you're a fan, he feels he owes it to you because you're paying for all the staff. Mm-hmm. So he has all the time in the world for fans if they catch him at an okay moment. And for the staff in the behind the scenes, you're signing an NDA and good luck.
I want to ask you about, and you'll forgive me if I don't remember his first name. Was it Terry Kilgore?
Terry Kilgore, yeah.
You said he agreed to be interviewed and then he pulled out.
Yeah.
And then also in the book, I don't know why I'm holding it up. Also in the book, you mentioned that he might have been the guy who taught Eddie or prompted Eddie to do finger tapping.
That's what Dave said in some promotional interview, which I think is just lore. Like, yes, there was guitar. And if I interrupted you or I stopped.
No.
So if you look at the early guitar gods of that scene, you hear about Kilgore, George Lynch, you know, there's your handful of people along those lines. Chris Holmes from Wasp, his name doesn't get thrown out a lot, but he was a peer of Eddie's. So you hear those names. But then when I interviewed Stephen Piercy and I asked him about Terry Kilgore, he didn't know who that was. And I said, but he has a co-write on a Rat album. He's like, a lot of people do. A lot of people have been in Rat. And or said that they were in Rad, and I go, I have no idea who that person is. So Dave's saying that he may have taught Eddie the finger tapping, but then the guy didn't really do anything aside from being in Dave's band for on and off for a couple of years. You go like, the story has to be somewhere in between the two, that he's a local legend, but only in Dave's band for a little bit. I don't know.
He seems like an interesting guy who's got an interesting story. I bet there's a story in there.
There is a story. After he turned me down, I did some background research, and he's still Facebook friending me, but I never asked again. Like he said to me, I think he had a health issue. Like he almost died from a heart related thing, and he was public about this. And I said, hey, hope you're well, you know, and can we still tape that interview? And he said something like, and I don't do book interviews because Greg Renoff didn't send me a copy of his book. And like, what does that have to do with me? And also, whoever is allowed to criticize Greg Renoff because he's the best and should be on the payroll of Van Halen personally. Greg Renoff is doing more for Van Halen's legacy than just about anybody.
Unfortunately, the band is just surrounded by so much dysfunctional stories at this point, you know.
I'm with you.
They are in the pantheon of great rock bands like Zeppelin, like the Stones. But unfortunately, there's just like a pigpen black cloud above them.
Yeah. When you talk about Zeppelin, yeah, there's four camps because there's Bonham's Widow's camp. There's Page's camp, Plant's camp, and John Paul Jones. But they've been able to work together to get stuff done. Yes, they've been quiet and seemingly dormant over the years, but the reissues have happened. There's that documentary, I believe, still coming soon. We get Zeppelin stuff. And with Van Halen, okay, so there's Michael's camp, there's Sammy's camp, there's the Eddie estate, the Alex estate, the Dave thing. Then you have one or two former managers who may or may not have a stake. That's still never verified. Then, of course, there's the Azoff camp on everything. Then there's the Wolfie camp now, because watch that he'll have a rebuttal in the very near future. Then you could argue there's the Valerie Bertinelli camp.
A lot of camps. It's a campground.
Yeah, there's so many camps. No wonder they can't get anything done.
It's a shame, because I think I'm preaching to the choir, but I mean, as a fan, we want to love you guys.
Just let us love you.
According to Henry Rollins, David Lee Roth was not a fan of the Jerky Boys. And it's odd. It's odd that a guy who is pretty culturally insensitive took umbrage with the Jerky Boys. I mean, I get the rationale. Really?
And that one came from Fox News correspondent Kennedy.
Oh, really?
Yeah. I interviewed Kennedy, who told me a story backstage that I'd never heard of, a backstage VMA thing that I never heard of that I put in the book, about the Van Halen MTV botched reunion. And then when I was able to get a Q&A with Henry Rollins to promote a stand-up tour of his, I shoehorned in a Dave Questioner 3. And I think Blabbermouth or whoever picked it up as clickbait. But I asked about that Jerky Boys story, and I don't get why Dave wouldn't like the Jerky Boys, because the openings to the videos of California Girls and Just a Gigolo. Those are basically Jerky Boys characters. Same with Yankee Rose. Dave was basically doing the Howard Stern whack pack way before Howard Stern was. Am I wrong? Are you a Stern guy? I mean, Connecticut.
No. And I'll tell you why. I'm more of a Stern. I respect him. I respect everything he did for radio. I don't like toilet humor as a rule. I don't like misogyny as a rule. I think he's grown out of that. And I think he's probably one of the best interviewers, if not the best interviewer of anyone, really. He just knows how to get stories from people. And I think that's brilliant. But coming up, you know, I would listen to him periodically. I could stand him for about 30 minutes. And then the minute somebody did a tit joke, and I'm like, I'm done.
Okay, so where I'm going with all that is the Stern whack pack was, if you were to really sum it up, it's that you regularly have this guy on the air. And you go, okay, so does he have a new album? No. Does he have a new movie? No. Book? No. Is he talented? No. So what does he do? He stutters. Oh, okay, we'll give him a job. And this guy, what does he do? He's mentally deficient. So we'll ask him trivia questions. Oh, okay. If you look at the beginning of the Eat 'em and Smile era videos, that's kind of what that is. The Jerry Persigian putting on a fake unibrow to be the shopkeeper in the Yankee Rose convenience store part.
I can't believe it, okay? My honeymoon night, okay? I will probably only have 3 or 4 more of these in my whole entire lifetime. And you check me into that dump your brother calls a motel.
But Consuelo, I gave him $2 extra for the fantasy suite.
Too bad, honey, too bad. We must sleep there. So tonight, you will have to fantasize that you have a wife. Okay.
Our lips are so close.
Ooh, not if you was the last immigrant grocer on earth, honey.
Son of a biscuit, my ancestors spit on your haircut.
Can you help me? My doctor said I have to take laxative.
Not in my store, you don't.
Give me a bottle of anything and a glazed donut. To go.
Those are not far off from Saul Rosenberg and Frank Rizzo and Tarbosh, the Egyptian magician.
Yeah.
And by the way, the wife and I played a Jerky Boys track at our wedding. You know, the music just stopped and we played a minute Saul Rosenberg call.
Because nothing beats a good prank phone call.
Prank phone calls are not in vogue anymore because, you know, the phone number shows up on the cell phone most of the time. But, you know, Dave was big on like stereotypes and these weirdo bizarro characters. So for him to go, yeah, this is not funny because you're victimizing people. And you go, what about the little people that you had pretending to be your security guards and the female bodybuilders in bikinis as your security and the triplets that you toted around on tour, like as your sideshow, and the no holds barbecue when you have naked Karen McDougal next to the little person and you're wearing Muslim veils. What about those things? You know,
Dave.
When I started writing this book, I thought Dave was the greatest. I thought he was the greatest and he was misunderstood. And the more people I talk with who worked with him, it's a struggle to get a nice or pleasant story ever.
See, I didn't get that reading the book. I come away, and granted, I think I'm still, I got up to Tokyo, Dave. I come away with it with the same thing I went into it with. He's like, he's probably sometimes good, sometimes bad. I wasn't terribly shocked.
The book is like 95% positive. I would say, you know, what's the worst thing I say? That he tells things differently and remembers things differently as time goes on, and the other people in the room remember it entirely different, and he decides he doesn't want to know you anymore and he's moved on but never told you. Yeah, that's kind of the worst stuff I say. I don't do anything that that is mean. But after I wrote this book, everyone started unloading all of their. So I used to work with Dave, and you go, oh God, can you give me a positive story? Did he like, did he give you a nice bottle of wine? Were you on his Christmas card list, his Hanukkah list? Anything, please? And then I'm going to say 80% of the feedback from people is, oh my God, this is horrifying. Why are you doing this? And then the 20%-ish is like, you guys are snowflakes. You guys are absolute snowflakes. He's kidding. He's absolutely kidding. Can't you take a joke? And people who used to work with Dave, then after each one of these come out, people who were in his house, who worked with him long term, go, these are terrible. I've never heard him say one nice thing behind the scenes about Eddie ever. So meaning these aren't jokes. Like, he might be laughing. He might have like goofy music in the background, but I'm horrified. The Wolfgang one really, really bothers me. It was the first thing that we talked about.
Yeah.
Here.
Tell me why.
And he says, and the kid, the effing kid, and you go, wait a second. The effing kid on that last tour was 24. When Van Halen 1 came out, you were 23. So I don't think that's, you know, sometimes you have to think about numbers and how old people were.
But let me push back a little bit on that, Darren, because he's 69.
Now he is 69, but he's saying, and the kid is complaining that I won't look at him. And he's telling everybody I won't look at him. Well, was Wolfgang the music director who everyone was watching for cues? Because I think he was. And when you are in a band, an MD, as people in the industry call it, there's one person designated in the band, usually, that everyone is watching for the cues to know when to vamp, when to wrap up. Because whether or not you're playing to a click track, there's lighting cues, there's pedals being pushed, things of that nature. Eddie was not the music director in Van Halen. It was either Wolf or Alex. And I'm thinking it was Wolf, because as the story goes, Wolf chose the set list, or at least he told them which songs they should play at the beginning. So you're supposed to look at the music director. And does that make me sense of? No, it goes, you've got a singer who won't look at the person that he's working. He won't look at his dance partner. The singer doesn't run the show entirely. The singer is on a team here, and you do have to be a team player to a certain extent. If Britney Spears is on stage, yes, it's her dancing and questionably singing, but there's a music director that everybody is watching, whether or not you see the eye contact or notice it.
Now, forgive my ignorance, but is that true? And when Van Halen was coming up, was there somebody with an MD title, or were they just sort of loosey-goosey?
I think they would have been loosey-goosey, and I think it would have been Alex really calling the shots. But in a band with somebody like Dave, who could go on an 8-minute story tear out of nowhere, or who could just randomly talk about a memory at that venue, and you don't know if it's going to go 10 seconds or 10 minutes, you do have to have onstage communication. I get that he's trying to entertain, but top level artists have a music director. They do have somebody who's, whether or not it's an official title, someone who's leading and calling the shots there. You know, I would guess, and this is just a guess, I don't know. I would guess in Aerosmith, it's Buck Johnson, the keyboard player, who sings a lot of...
God knows it's none of the five.
I don't think it is. I would think that it's Buck Johnson who's doing the keyboards and the harmony vocals to ease off of Steven Tyler. You go through all these bands over the years, and you kind of look at it, and you'll know somebody's leading the show here. It's not loosey-goosey like they want you to think it is. Somebody is choosing the set list and or giving the cues to everybody else.
Yeah, it can't be as loosey-goosey as it once was anymore. It's a business. It's a big business.
No, it's a business. Yeah. So, you know, I couldn't tell you a Metallica. I'd have to watch, or I'd have to ask around. I don't know if it's Lars. There's a chance that it's Lars who's leading the whole thing.
That would be on brand.
Yeah.
What's going on with Alex Van Halen? I think Alex Van Halen is probably one of the greatest rock and roll drummers of our generation. He just happened to be in a band with his brother, who was the greatest guitar player of our generation, of many generations.
Yeah.
So he's often overlooked. But even Wolfgang has said things, I'm paraphrasing, like, well, there's one person that doesn't want to talk. There's one person that won't talk about it. And it's very clear who it is. Do you know anything about there's other? I know in the past there have been substance issues. And I ask this out of genuine concern, not for anything salacious.
I think there's a lot more to the story than has been publicly released. And some of it I can't say until some of my sources decide they no longer care about NDAs and things of that nature. But it's, I'll just put it to you this way. It's not like no one tried to get a tribute thing off the ground. And it's not like nobody ever tried to play together ever again. There were attempts. It's just Van Halen's one of these camps that doesn't release it until they feel it's time to release it because it's tied in with a tour or an album or something they can monetize. Whereas other bands will sell you every bit of drama and every offshoot project that they can and product that they can. In the case of Van Halen, it's just they're an odd duck. They don't keep the website or social media up to date. Usually they updated it within the last 2 months, but I'd heard that there wasn't like RIP Eddie for a long time on that site. I don't know how true that was.
Wow.
And if you're somebody like Alex, of course you're sad and you're mourning and all that kind of stuff, but you also have to think, so if I do nothing, how many millions of dollars come in this year if I do absolutely nothing? And if I work really hard, does a lot more money come in? No? Okay. Well, I like being home. I love my wife and family. Why do I have to do all that? He doesn't have to do anything. And is it going to be any better than it was in 2015? Probably not, with the probably diminishing returns in the 8 to 9 years of inactivity since then. As great as he is, you know, around the age of 70, how great is he going to be on Hot for Teacher or Light Up the Sky or Unchained?
Yeah.
It probably would not be a good look. It would probably attract a lot of negative attention.
Truthfully, Darren, I had not thought of it like that. And if that's the case, then good play.
Well, I'll ask you this. Have you heard the 2015 live Van Halen album, the Live in Tokyo?
Oh, I think once.
Yeah. Most people heard it once.
Yeah. I didn't even like that last album. I thought that was just...
Oh, you didn't like A Different Kind of Truth?
No, I did not.
I love it. I initially thought it stunk. Then I listened to it again and again and again. I know that there's a couple of clunkers on it, but some of it is classic Van Halen. It grows on you.
My thing with that is it's too long. One thing that Van Halen did really well, I mean, Fair Warning is my favorite Van Halen record.
Sure.
It is 31 minutes long. That's it. It is literally the definition of all killer, no filler.
84 is also a short album.
Yeah.
All killer, no filler. I'm with you there. It is too long. It does have a couple of gems on there. Tattoo is god awful. If anyone tells you that they like the song Tattoo, I question their choices in life. I would not take investment advice from them. If they said that this was the best steakhouse they ever went to, I would go, okay, so I'm never going there. Great. If you like Tattoo, you are not right in the head.
Yeah.
But She's the Woman's fantastic. And Chinatown and Honey Baby Sweet It All, there's some cool songs on there. 2015 is abysmal, that live album. The 2020 shows I saw with my wife in Vegas were fun. Watching them on YouTube, the band's incredible. He's not.
Stop!
So if Dave were to go, here's my tour in 2024, you're going to go, so this is 9 years removed from that live album and 4 years removed from that residency. It's not going to be a good look.
No. And I remember seeing them at the Garden. And that would have been, what, 2008, 9?
I think 2008 they also did the Garden, yeah.
You're not going to see Dave's vocal performance. You're going to see Van Halen.
I thought he was great on that tour, that first tour.
He was fine, you know. I mean, admittedly, I had way too much to drink. I just remember I enjoyed the hell out of it.
Yeah.
You know, but even when you watch rehearsals with him, it's like he's never been the greatest vocalist.
I disagree. I think that
really
he had a really solid, I think 99 to 2007. He wasn't perfect on the first Van Halen run, but I think in the 99 to 2005, when he was basically auditioning for Van Halen again, going, I'm ready, guys, I'm ready. He's excellent because you look at he's doing all the kicks and all the yelps, all the yows, he's doing all that kind of stuff. He's hitting the notes. He's actually singing the songs. So he's that physical and he's singing great. If he were to just focus, lose the ADHD and just focus on the vocals, there would be excellent performances. But he takes it down to focus on the acrobatics and sing. And I think he's top notch.
Okay.
Watch Finland 99. That is one of my obsessions. It is still on YouTube because it was an MTV concert. That aside from the wardrobe, aside from him licking a camera person, groping female fans he puts on the side of the stage, telling another cameraman that he's going to physically harm him. Aside from that, perfect show.
Well, it sounds it.
Sounds just like a brand new one to me. What do you think, Mark? Brand new song, just coming out now. Let it take.
You've done a lot in rock and roll.
I've been around. I mean, I started when I was a teenager in high school. I didn't want to, you know, do things like have fun and talk to people my age. I wanted to hang out with older people. So I tried interning and writing for newspapers and writing for punk rock scenes. So a lot of times I'd be interviewing people and they'd be like, you're 17. What are you doing here? Why do you know my music? You know, I grew up liking music meant for older people. I was never trying to be the top 40 guy after I was 10. So that explains a lot, hopefully.
It does. Darren, thank you for your time. And I did enjoy the book very much. And I'm glad I have it.
Thanks, Keith. That's a lot of post-it notes. I say kudos to anyone who puts post-its in books.
Oh, there's highlights in here. There's the Henry Rollins note. Never know what I want to reference.
Thanks a ton for having me.
All right, man.
Keep up the great work with your show.
Thank you so much, man. I appreciate it. Take care.
You too.
Bye-bye.
And now a word from our sponsor.
Many thanks to Darren for taking the time to talk with us about his book. You can pick up DLR Book, How David Lee Roth Changed the World, wherever you get your favorite books, like your favorite independent bookseller. Be sure to check out Darren's podcasts, The DLR Cast, and Paltrowcast with Darren Paltrowitz. We've got links in the show notes. Paltrowcast also airs regularly on over 80 television stations.
This episode of Abandoned Albums was written and produced by Keith R. Higgins. The show was recorded at Thunderlove Studio, where it was engineered by
Daphne Morris,
with help from
John Thomas.
Abandoned Albums was edited by
Mike Hunt.
Our theme song is Booty Cooler by Shuggy Otis. In the opening of the show, the songs you heard were Rumble by Link Ray, 16 Tons by Tennessee Ernie Ford, and the Carpenters classic Top of the World, performed by Shonen Knife. You can stream all of those songs and artists wherever you stream your favorite music.
Original music by Mike Pellegrino.
The songs you heard during this podcast were Yankee Rose, Just Like Paradise, California Girls, A Lil Ain't Enough, Unchained from a live 2020 show in Las Vegas, and Slam Dunk from the Finland 99 show that Darren mentions. We also snuck in Van Halen's Panama, just because we like it. You can stream all of David Lee Roth's work wherever you stream your favorite music.
If you like what you've heard, please be sure to subscribe and leave us a rating. It really does help. Thanks for listening.
Grazie.
Daily Leaf.
Rob Janicki. Mike Pellegrino. Therina Vella. Ronnie Barnett. S.W. Loudon. Michael Janicki. Peyton Janicki. And our executive producer.
This is Thunderlove.
Abandoned Albums receives funding from Damon Pharmaceuticals, the makers of Ben Affleck. Ben Affleck is the only chewable tablet made to combat stomach unease associated with mediocrity. Taken daily, Ben Affleck can help combat explosive gastrointestinal shame. You can find a multitude of flavors in the incontinence section of your local pharmacy. Ben Affleck, save yourself the embarrassment.
The side effects include dry mouth, headache, anal leakage, muscle soreness, bad decisions, gender confusion, constipation, evil spirit possession, and banality. Use only as directed.
And now, until we meet again next time, I remain as always obediently yours.
Abandoned Albums is a production of Paw Print Media.
And now, a word from our sponsor.